I'm Mark Weber of the Computer History Museum, and we're here with Daniel Anabee, who's a major pioneer of Minitel services and software, and has gone on to a career in at Orange Research in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. Doing the interview, the main person will be Julien Maillande, and Bernard Puteaux is also here to add questions. So thank you very much, Daniel, for doing this.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. And I'm glad to be here at the Computer History Museum to be able to talk of this fantastic period in time.
And it's March 20th, 2015. So Julien, do you want to start with a question?
Yeah. Why don't we start with a big picture? You're here because you're a pioneer of online services on a platform called Minitel.
Yes.
One of those flagship services was called 3615 SM,
3615 SM.
Mm-hmm. Let's pretend this is the mid-80s. Mm-hmm. I'm an American. I've just mm-hmm. landed in Paris. I know nothing about Minitel, mm-hmm. but I see these intriguing billboards yeah. everywhere
yes.
saying 3615 SM.
Yes.
Can you give me the elevator pitch? What is it? What should I go on it? How do I get on
yes.
it? And then what am I gonna find?
Yeah. So we put many ads, and one of the main ads we have at the time was in the subway. So we put many ads in the subway paths, and it was the SM was declined in many forms. So, for example, we put super messagerie for super messagerie, server medical, of course, and many, many things. But people first went to the service because we started with a small network of doctors, of MDs, that used it to communicate together. And by word of mouth, they gave this name to their friends, and slowly it came to a huge mass of people that were willing to come on the server to just be able to chat together. It was like Facebook today, in fact, because it was a mur de messagerie, as we called it, and there were salons. So people were able to connect in these small places and chat. So they were taking a persona because they were able to use a nickname to connect. And so they were just, you know, chatting together and trying to make friends. And so there was nothing similar at the time. There was nothing similar, and people were discovering a way to connect through an electronic mean. And so at that point, we were able to see that these people were trying to experiment many ways of chatting. So a lot of people were simply genuine, but a lot of them were taking, you know, a mask and trying to, I don't know, seduce or chat or just have fun on the system.
Great. Before we go in depth about your business and the evolution of what you did online, let's talk a little bit about your background so we understand mm-hmm, where you're mm-hmm, coming mm-hmm. from.
So, yeah.
What is your name? Where were you born?
Yeah.
What was your family background?
Yes. So I was born in France in a town called Fontainebleau, if some of you know where it is. It's south of Paris, and there's a magnificent chateau there, the Chateau de Fontainebleau, and the nice forest where I spent a lot of my weekends when I was young. And my parents were French. My mother was French. My father was Egyptian. And they left Egypt when they had to, they were expelled from Egypt. So they came to France and they arrived in Fontainebleau, and there I was born. At that point, what was the question again?
Just talk about growing up and family.
So we moved to Paris, and well, that's it. And I started my my medical school because I wanted to. To help people to be well. So I was I wanted to be a doctor, and so I spent 8 years in medical school, and at the end I wanted to be a surgeon, but I was not sure I was able to get the grade to be able to choose my place of surgeon as an interne en chirurgie. So I was a bit hesitant, and at the time I met a friend with whom we started this service, and I slowly moved to doing just what I was passionate about. So that was a computer.
But sorry to go back to your childhood and background. Mm-hmm. Do you want to?
Yeah, did you have any technical hobbies at the time? Or
when I was, I loved to play and, you know, use anything with the electronic inside. You know, I was drained to, all these components, you know, you can assemble and do something with, and whatever was the result, even if it didn't work, it was really exciting to be able to assemble these small components and see that something that you can create will do certain things. So that was exciting. Yeah, I loved that. Yeah.
What kind of things did you make?
You know, everything you can find in these early, like popular mechanics. We didn't have that in France, but you know, they were showing some, electronic schemes. So you were able to do. I don't remember. So you know, the thing you do when you're young. So, for example. Something with light controlling a strobe, or I don't know, something, this kind of stuff.
And talk a little bit about your childhood. What was your neighborhood like? What did you like to do?
It's dim memories. So I was just, you know, riding my bike. Don't remember much, but yeah,
Were your parents in technical fields?
No, my father was a photograph. He was working with the shape, you know, in Saint-Germain-en-Laye. My mother was doing accounting at Siemens in Paris. So nothing technical about that, but I just, you know, went and read all these magazines on electronics, and I was really interested by that. But the computer and the software came after, because it took so much space to build all these things that it was very difficult to sustain. So everything was, I need to have a lot of space on my small desk. So at one point I said, it's not possible, I can't do this anymore, I need more space. So I switched to software because it didn't require as much space. And it was the same excitement because you were able to build, to create stuff that will do things, but you didn't need all the soldering tools and such things.
And you know, may I ask you about what values you were raised with?
My parents are Jewish, but they never pushed me to any kind of beliefs. So I was really drawn to Buddhism. So I'm a Jewish Buddhist.
There are many.
So, yeah.
And favorite teachers?
Yeah, how was school? Did you enjoy school? Anything that you learned? Any favorite teachers?
Yeah, school, yeah. I remember one thing that was really nice when I was in my, second and premier, so I don't know what's the grade here.
High school.
Yeah, high school. So that we had this, we had the chance to have in our school a big computer system that was part of a government program. So, and the math teacher wanted us to try that and to be exposed to that technology. So it was really, for me, it was incredible to go and type these things on the terminal. And so my first program was one of chemistry. So I was able to enter some line of codes, and it was giving me the ratio of carbon, you know, hydrogen, oxygen of a component I entered. So that was really fantastic at the time.
What year was it, and what system
it was in 75, yeah, 75, 76.
And what system was it?
I don't remember the name of the system. I don't remember. But I'm sure we can find. I checked a few months ago, and I found some archives on the web that were talking about it. So I'm sure we can find it. It was a system that used printed the tapes, you know, to perforated tapes to save the programs. That was really fun.
And was this, you said earlier that you taught yourself software and coding? Was
yes,
that at home or was
it
that
was
at school?
It was at home, and it was you know, using binary code.
Okay.
You know, with the very first computers.
So you had a micro computer?
Like Altai? No, I was just doing this by, you know, writing. So it was. I checked the Altair, you know, on a review, and I was trying to see how I can build one myself, but it was too much, too expensive for me at the time. Yeah.
So what was your first computer that you?
So the first computer was named DAI. And it was sold by a Belgian company, and it was kind of they wanted to compete with the Apple One Apple One at the time, and they were selling this computer for 14,000 francs at the time. So I had a big discussion with my parents, and so I finished by getting this computer, and it was really the beginning of something really interesting, because it helped me go deep into the programmation in assembly, and because of that I was able after to to refine the code we had on the server system to go faster.
And was that when you were in high school or in college?
This was in 82, I guess. So it was after high school. After high school.
And so when was the first time you heard about going online?
It was at the time we met with François. And I knew Minitel, but I was not really involved in Minitel at the time. So as soon as I met François, we were searching for some idea to build some system for the doctors. We wanted to help, you know, doing some kind of software for doctors, whatever was possible at the time. So it was maybe system experts or something that will help them, you know, diagnose something. But it was maybe too complicated for us. So we were thinking, and we saw this Minitel. These Minitels, and we just, you know, thought that it was a really interesting idea, and it was a really new field, and we wanted to do this the system to help doctors communicate and be able to learn. So it was we wanted to do formation continue for the doctors. So it was a way for them to be able to find any new system of diagnosis or this technique, medical technique. So we wanted to do this kind of thing. So we succeeded building the server, and it was at the time it was not on the Teletel network. It was modem based, so it was a regular phone number, and we plugged modems behind the computer, and the number was I think it was I don't remember. So it was it ended with 10-10 and 15-15, and we chose 15-15 because 15 was the number for the emergency in France. The died 15, so you can have the ambulance coming to you, to your house. And the system we built was working fine. We invested a lot of the money we had in it, and we didn't. We were not able to get money out of it. So we were searching for a way to do money with that system, and first thing we tried was putting ads on the Minitel pages, and so we put we were able to create ads for a laboratoire. So it was the first one was Organon. So we put an ad for a pill, a contraceptive. So we needed to put les mentions légales of the medicine on the ad, and it took many pages because the mention légale was very small, and the Minitel sadly, was not able to display a lot of characters. So people, when they were checking the ad, had to check, scroll like maybe 10 pages. So it didn't work as we expected, because people would just, you know, disconnect because they were not happy with the fact that they have to display everything. So we tried that. We made a little money out of it, and So it was not the right direction.
Sorry, but you were charging by the for access card?
We were kind of we made a deal with this pharmaceutical company, and we made a deal to display their ads for every connection at the beginning of every connection.
But not on Minitel, on your own BBS. Mm.
Sorry?
Before it was connected to Minitel.
Yeah, it was not on Teletel. This was on the regular numbers.
But the ads were on Minitel.
On Minitel, yes.
But then how would you monetize? You were just...
We just signed a deal with the pharmaceutical company. I don't remember exactly what was the deal, but it was an amount of money for a few months to display for everyone the ad.
What is François' name?
And Lagarde, François Lagarde.
And what year did you guys meet?
It was in 83, I guess, 83, 84, and because he had the same computer as the one I bought. We bought the same computer, and so we met in the club of users. And so I was doing a lot of small ads, apps for this computer, and providing them to the club, and the club sold them to users to make some money. And so he saw my apps, and he was really interested. And at that point, he asked me to if I was interested to start this system with him. And
was he a medical student as well?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so you were in what year of?
I was at the end, so as I said, it was my last year, and I just switched.
And he was same.
He was older than me, so he was I think 5 years older than me. So he was he stopped also because he was already doing some software for doctors, but I think it was an accounting software. So, and he stopped also to be able to sell this software, and it was working on a small, I don't remember which kind of small computer he used, but it was kind of a small tablet with a basic interpreter inside, so with a one-line display on it. So I have an ad of the software so maybe I will be able to find it.
So in the original setup, the user would use a Minitel terminal,
yes,
but not go on the Transpac network,
no,
just use on the regular PSTN and
yes,
connect
yes,
to your server.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What hardware did you use? What software did you use for that?
So it was, the hardware was called a Goupil. And we used Uniflex as the software, and it had a basic interpreter. So we were doing the back end using assembly language, and the apps in BASIC.
Okay. And so, going back to the evolution of your business model,
mm-hmm,
when did you make the decision to switch from that model to using the 3615, which was the kiosk system on the digital Transpac network? Yeah.
So at one point, the server was very popular. So we had to double the number of lines, to quadruple, I don't remember exactly. But at one point, we had 32 lines, modems. And there were always busy. Everything was busy all the time. So, so we were we didn't make any money out of it. So we were really we're in need of making money because this was costing us some money out of our pocket. So, and there was this 3615 coming that came a few months ago, a few 1 year ago, and it was only for la presse, only for les éditeurs de presse, and so we were not at all, you know, an editor, and so we were trying to find something to let us in. So at one point we asked all the magazines dealing with medicine so we went to see them and we asked them if they were interested by hosting. So we hosted their summary, their monthly summary on our system. And in exchange, they signed us a letter that they were, you know, on our system. So we ended up with a few, maybe 10 letters of éditeurs de presse. And we used that to try to get a 3615. And well, it worked. By chance, it worked. And so at one point we were able to switch from the non-paying system to something that was getting us like maybe, I don't know, one franc per minute of connection. So when we switched to that, we were of course afraid that people will not connect because, you know, it's a lot of money, it's expensive. And well, they connected, they came to the service. And. And so at that point, we were very afraid of the fact that we were not going to be able to scale the system because it was these small computers. They did not have a bigger version of the system. So we searched for a new way to serve or to install the system. And. We had to go on something that was using Unix because our system was Unix based, and so we found that AT&T was using these 3B2 and 3B5 computers Unix based, and they were sold by Olivetti at that time. So we asked Olivetti to lend us a small one to try to move our system to this computer, to install it on this computer, and it took a few months maybe because it was not exactly the same, you know. The way of programming was more complex because it was an ATT based Unix, and well, it was a bit harder for us that were not, you know, really technical. So we finally we were able to port the software on it, and so we made we had to decide to buy this big computer at the time that was a 3B15, and the cost for the 3B15 was at the time $1.5 million. So it was a lot of money for us because we just we didn't have any. But we were, you know, we were against the wall because if we didn't do the investment, it was we would have to shut down everything. So we went to a bank. We described all what was going on, and we bought the system, and it was. Happily reimbursed in a few months because we were able to open, you know, the doors, and people came in and rushed in, and we were having like maybe 10 times the volume of connection that we had before the system was installed.
And the name, well, what was your volume?
At the time, we had maybe between 160 and 200 connections at a time. all the time.
And before going on Teletel, mm-hmm. what was the name of the service then?
It was SM, but it has four numbers. It was a regular phone number.
Okay. So, I mean, the various communities that were attracted to SM started mm-hmm. before going to Teletel.
Yes, yes.
So who were the main users?
It was, you know, at the beginning it was, as I said, doctors and medical professions and their friends, because it went out by the word of mouth. And people were just coming to the service to have fun. They spent all night long on the service, you know, on the servers in the chat rooms, just to have fun. It was, they were, you know, making jokes and you know, just simple chat.
But when did the S&M community get involved and become significant?
Which community, sorry?
S&M.
SM. No, it stayed only on, it was Messagerie Rose at the moment we started on 3615, because there was a lot of people coming in, and it was, you know, it was not S&M really. At no point it went into an S&M community. It was really more Messagerie Rose.
Okay. But I mean, before going on 3615,
yes.
It was not especially
doctors. It was mainly
it
doctors.
It really was yeah. social between doctors.
Yes, yes. And their friends.
Okay. So more of.
Yeah, and their friends. Because as soon as the doctor gave the number, the service was busy all the time. The people couldn't enter because it was busy. So they called, it was ringing busy, they hung up, they called, and doing this all the time.
And it was both live chat, but also messages, right? I mean, you could send
yes,
email,
so it
but
was,
stay
yeah.
in your box.
It was kind of an email platform, because you could, you know, leave a message for a user. So user register and use the nickname. It was the way they were associated to the service, and the nicknames were unique. So once a nickname was used, it couldn't be used by anyone else. So people were able to leave messages, enter the salon, so where there were five of them, and they were able to chat together. So people could allow others to come in, or you know, disallow people to come in, and you had a list of users connected, so you were able to see if your friend was there, and at that point, well, when we had the modem, lines, at one point the server was so busy that it. It took a fire. It just burned. It just burned, and our two servers were destroyed. And of course, we didn't have any backup at that time. So during maybe a few weeks, we had to, you know, rewrite everything. And so the moment we plugged the new system in. Instantaneously, the all the lines were busy. So that was a reinsurance for us.
And what were the five salons?
So what was
what
it?
Were the five salons?
No, so in a salon, you were able to have five users at a time.
Ah, okay.
But you were able to create as many salons
as you
want.
Yeah.
Right.
So in order to get on the 3615 platform, which is just for our audience, the mm-hmm. platform where users would pay by the minute,
mm-hmm.
You first had to pretend that you were a press company.
Exactly.
And you managed to do that by getting medical magazines to
yes,
sponsor
yes,
you.
Yes, yeah.
But then you had to get a server.
Uh-huh.
But then you also had to get to lease digital line from France Telecom, called Transpac.
Of course.
How complicated was it to get that? How long did it take? How much did it cost?
It was a complicated process, and it took a few months. It took a few months for us because we were not used at all to that, because we were not in this business before. We just tried to get all this together, and we went to see France Telecom, and so they had to explain us how it worked. So we went to buy these boxes to connect Transpac in a certain location in Paris that was the only reseller of these boxes, and it took a few months. I don't remember exactly, but.
And do you remember how much the line cost?
Yeah, I think it was like maybe a few, maybe 1,000 to a few thousand francs a month. I don't remember exactly.
Okay. Yeah. And how many calls could you handle at once?
So per line, we had 32 users.
Okay.
So at one point, we had we started with a few lines, and at one point we had like maybe 10 or 20 lines for us and the other service we hosted.
Right, so going on that, over time you diversified your business model, right?
Yes.
So you had the servers hosting 3615 SM,
yes,
which was a Minitel
the messagerie,
host,
yes,
chat room.
Yeah.
But then you, so what did you do then?
So yeah, we wanted, at one point, everything was working fine. We had a lot of money pouring in the company, and we didn't need to do anything more for that, because the traffic was going on the upper level, and that was fine. So we spent a lot of our time at the cafe in front of the company, and so we were searching for some new ideas to innovate in our small field, and there was a new thing going on with in the US that was the downloading of files, using I don't remember CompuServe at the time, or maybe, and they were using this protocol that was called Kermit. I'm sure you know about Kermit, and so we had the idea to let users of Minitel connect their device to a PC, to a computer, and let them download files from our servers, and that was really new at the time, and so we had to build this cable that was connecting the Minitel to the PC or the Atari at the time, or the Mac also, and so we used. We had to create a new protocol because Kermit was not able to handle the asymmetric speed of the Minitel modem. So we had to create something completely different that was able to handle that. And so we did this protocol called Quicktel. And we did a press conference to release at the release of this service in the Fnac auditorium. So we invited journalists, and so we showed them this new service, and it did a lot of it created a lot of buzz, and people went and so downloaded the electronic schema of this cable. A few created this cable themselves, and we start selling these cables. And at one point, the service was making more money than the Messagerie Rose. Yeah, because it sold really a lot of of cables, and we had a lot of magazines, computer magazines, using it. So we hosted like maybe five services using this Quicktel system.
Which services?
So, for example, maybe it was PC magazine, the French one. We had that one. We had at one point it was used also by CompuServe. We handled the French node for CompuServe, so they were using our protocol to let people download files in France. There were SVM used our system also. There were a few names.
And you told us before the interview about the pricing model. What was the pricing?
So we sold the cable for like maybe between, at the beginning it was like 60 francs, and at the end maybe 160 maybe francs. And so this it was a bundle with the cable and 3.5 floppy disk.
And what was your cost for that?
And so we had a deal with the company, I think it was in Rennes, that was doing the cables, and we bought the cables like maybe 10 francs at the best cost.
And you say you sold a million of them?
A million, yeah. It was a million of them were used, yeah.
And what year?
It was between 85 and 92.
Mm. So you also mentioned when I spoke earlier that you were leasing server space to other Minitel host site.
Yes, we're hosting.
Okay.
Yeah. So at one point when the service was really, you know, popular, we had users coming to see us, and they wanted to have their own server. So, for example, it was press editors that were interested in this kind of system. So they came to see us. They were regular users. They loved the system, the interaction between users, the type of apps that were available, the type of games that were available. So they came and asked us, okay, can you do the same thing for us? So we are not ready for that because we didn't do it. So so we are asking ourselves, so are we going to go this way or not? And since if we didn't get the client, some other company will certainly get it, we decided to start to host other services.
So what were some of those services?
So I think the first one was called Eden, E-D-E-N. And it was a messagerie, okay. Mainly messagerie. They used the salon and the messagerie. So there were a few of them. It was not in the big numbers, but there were at least like maybe 10 of them,
And just so the messagerie were used mostly for kind of sex-oriented chat, right?
Yeah, you know, friendly, sexy, you know, chatting. Messagerie rose, so, yeah.
Right.
So.
But many people will not, outside of France in that era, don't necessarily know what. So what's a typical?
Messagerie rose, you mean? Well, it's they were using this for dating. You know, they were trying to find a companion. Sometimes we had a few people that were able to marry with the service. We had like maybe five couples that were married. That's not a lot, but we knew that, and so yeah, it was kind of, you know, easy chatting. People were able to pour all their fantasies on the system, just, you know, saying whatever they were not able to say in the real life, they went on the service and take any. I remember people having like five or maybe ten different personals on the system, and maybe sometimes chatting on too many tales, having two different nicknames. So yeah, it's just, you know, people were bored with their lives, so they came on this and just expressed their many of their personalities.
And how, if for someone who used the messageries a lot, mm-hmm. It could be quite expensive.
It was very expensive. Very expensive.
So talk about the price.
Yeah, I remember one of the, in the first year we started this, I remember one person sending us a letter that she was asked by France Telecom a bill of 30,000 francs. So it was a lot of money at the time. 30,000 francs, it was really huge. And so she was asking for us to reimburse, but we couldn't do that. And so we just, a lot of people were connecting from office, from their offices. So, and we had a few lines for certain users that, you know, were really sometimes in need. So we offered some, you know, free time, not really free, but they paid a very small connection rate for these people. So, but yeah, the service was costly, and it was the way it worked. You know, people were paying a lot, but a lot of money came from the companies that were having, you know, Minitels, and maybe France Telecom had a lot of Minitel, and people in France Telecom were using them. I'm sure.
Did you want to ask?
Yeah, jump in on this. So it's so well known, as you confirmed, that people were connecting from work.
Yes.
Which for an American audience might be a little surprising, because you don't really see people in American offices going on porn sites on the web.
No, it was not porn.
Or
it was
on,
not
on
porn. Yeah.
No. Well. Sexy chat rooms.
Craigslist encounters.
No, but for example, I compare it to Facebook today.
Okay.
It's an equivalent of Facebook today. It's a way of you know, for people to connect together, to be able to even during the war, because they were able to chat about their problems at work, anything, what happened last night with a friend, you know, during a date, and it was a bit kind of sexy talks, but not only that.
Right.
It was more. It was a lot of friendly talks, okay. Being able to find a friend, someone you can talk with, you can spend time, you know, just. Talking about your fantasies and
the anonymity made people.
Yeah, anonymity.
Much looser.
Yeah, that was a very powerful thing at the time, because it was one of the first times that people were able to just put a mask and say whatever they wanted on this kind of system to. An audience that was there and was willing to read what they were saying. So there were famous users on the system.
And how did the privacy regime work? Because we know that people were able to connect from work because on the bill it didn't say what site they went on.
That's true, yeah.
But how much did you know about the users? How much did you keep on them, if anything?
Well, we didn't keep much, in fact. No, it was just they only had a nickname on the system. So that's the only thing we knew about them. So we didn't knew much.
So you didn't know where
people did you build them?
We didn't build them. Right. So that was kiosk. So France Telecom, at the end of the month, it was every 2 months. So they send us. It was a reversement. So they sent us our notre part.
Which was
so
what?
It was about I don't remember. I really don't remember. But it was a nice amount, and so they did the billing. So that was the good thing because we couldn't do the billing. It was too complicated for us, of course. When we were in the modem phase, we were thinking at that kind of model, but it was too complicated to. Because France Telecom, if someone didn't pay, they will just cut their line and go and send people to call them and get the money back.
And what percentage did what was your cut? Your percentage of if the user pays 10 francs, you would get how many?
I think we got, for example, it's a long time ago, so I don't remember the numbers, but like maybe for when it was 125, maybe we got one out of 125, something like that.
But you got the vast majority, though.
Yeah, we had, I think so, yeah.
So when you and Francois were sitting at this cafe outside of your office, And you talk about what services to provide and how to expand. Did you have any ideology in mind? Did you have any goal besides making money?
Well, we wanted. We liked the idea that this was a tool for people to communicate. That it helped people to get together because there was nothing at the time that let them communicate instantaneously. It was an instantaneous chat. You were able to connect on the screen, find a list of users, find friends that by nickname, address them, just ask them to go in a salon with you and chat. So it was a way to, that was a really, incredible for us because it was not possible before that. So we liked that idea, and we were doing everything to increase the experience, to ease the experience of letting people communicate together.
And was it just you and Francois, or were there other key
at that time, so we started together, and at one point we were after selling the company. At one point, it was like before selling, it was like maybe 10 or 14 people, I guess 14 people. Yeah.
Minitel is known to have been somewhat controversial in France. There were lots of billboards for the chat rooms that were quite suggestive. And a number of people got upset, the Catholic Families Association in particular, et cetera. So what were the legal things that you were concerned about? Did you self-censor? How did you monitor what was going on?
There were regulations, so we were responsible for the content. And we had to filter the content, and we could have been there could have legal actions taken for the service. If something happened on the service, and so we were using people to filter the messages. Even for the chat rooms, if something offensive was said, the user will be disconnected. And we will forbid the user to come back on the system. So we were doing constant filtering. So these users, there were people that were all the time on the service and they liked so much the service, we asked them if they were interested to do this job. And well, they did it because they liked it. So I think at one point we even at the end when all the Teletel experience went kind of down, at one point we even I think sold the service to one of these persons to use it for for themselves.
Now, what was frowned upon by the state? What were the lines? I remember when we talked last time, you mentioned you were hosting a site called 3615HG, Gay Man. And you said that these were monitored more than so the mainstream.
They were themselves éditeurs de presse. So they had people that were doing constant surveillance of every message going on through the service. And especially on these, because they were really, these were SNM services. This one, for example. So surveillance was a big part of the system at that point for this service.
So what kind of content would you filter out, because SNM is not illegal?
It was everything. Every message was filtered.
Right, but I mean, what were you looking for that you would kick people out for?
We were not in charge of that, because these guys were in charge of their system.
Okay.
So we were hosting them,
okay,
but they were in charge of the content. So they had people doing the filtering of every message coming in.
Okay.
But what was forbidden? What would they?
Racial pornography, offensive talks. Of course, prostitution was, of course, forbidden, and a few services were sued for prostitution at the time. I don't remember which one, but that was a very important part of the job, to kind of protect users of strong language and harassment.
So threats between users.
Because during chats, people could argue, of course, and French are always arguing. So, but we didn't have many problems. As soon as something was going too far, we just disconnected the people and. That was it on our side. I don't know what happened on HD, but I think they were okay.
And then pedophilia. That was illegal.
What happened on their system was their problem. We were just hosters.
But wasn't there the 3615 Navy?
Right. There was an incident that was kind of made public by the Catholic Families Association, where apparently some teenager wanted to become a sailor and went on 3615 Navy, which was a gay site.
Oh, yeah.
And they kind of brought that to the public attention.
Yeah, I don't remember that.
But is that something that worried you in terms of the sustainability of your business, to have that negative attention?
What was the year of that event? You remember?
I don't know.
No.
It was late 80s, I think.
We were concerned by the fact that as the owner of the name of the service, for example, Francis Quinzessen, we were abide by law. We were directeur de la publication, so we were responsible of the content. So for that, we took, you know, all the measures we had to by filtering, and that's it. But at one point, you know, after it was in 87, I guess, when we sold when we sold the service the company to Maxwell Group, it was the peak of the Minitel era, and after that, it kind of slowly went down. Connections kind of went down, and for bringing more connections, you had to have a very high sustained ads in the medias, and so at that point we kind of we were not too much involved in the in this kind of problems.
Now, let's talk a little bit about the people who were monitoring the system. There's a gentleman in France named Jean-Marc Manac, who writes for Le Monde sometimes, who has told the story of being a college student, and his job was to monitor the chat rooms, but at the same time pretend to be a user in order to get the conversation kind of going. Did you employ this type of people?
Yeah, of course. So this gentleman was called Lionel, and I don't remember his nickname. Maybe it will get back to my memory. But so this guy was responsible of the filtering and the conduct of the user. So he was able to get as many entry in the system as he wanted. So we gave him this authority, so he was able to connect as many users as needed to regulate, you know, the flow of conversations. So at one time he was able to chat as 10 different persons. So it oriented, you know, the whole communication flow in the system.
Did he have multiple terminals?
He had multiple terminals, and for that we created a software on PC. So he had the kind of a huge window, and on the windows he had all his sessions open, so he was able to create like 10 or 20 sessions on the PC that were all equivalent to a Minitel. So he was working on that PC most of the time.
And in your office, not at home?
He was at home. He was not in our office. He was in, the middle of France. Near Sarlac. Near Sarlac.
So he was, and how many people like that did you employ?
There were two. Okay. Two people.
And so they were connected 24/7?
Yeah, there were, you know, most of the time. As long as there were users on the system, they were there. And so these two people were working together, and they ended the husband and wife, and so they were working in the same room, and so they had all these Minitel terminals, and so since they were only chatting by Minitel, to talk to themselves, they were using the Minitel.
They were both good at chatting.
Exactly.
Did you need to get permission from the state in order to start your service? I know that when we talked, at some point you mentioned your partner having to get some authorization from someone and noticing that the lady from the state was actually on your
for
chat.
Yeah, we had this. So when we went to France Telecom, we had some. I think that the person that was responsible of the inscriptions, you know, authorization
to get
the short codes, was on our server, was on SM, and I think that helped a lot for us to get the.
But did she realize that you knew that?
Because at one point we told her, that's our system, I'm sure that helped a lot. Yeah, that was our luck this day. Yeah.
Let's talk maybe a little bit about the culture. It must have been quite an exciting time.
You were
doing something completely new.
Yeah.
How did it feel? And was it, you think, similar to what happened here with the .com?
Yeah, of course.
What was going on there? What was the excitement like?
It was a very much smaller communities, you know. There were a few companies doing that, so it was not as, you know, big as the Silicon Valley or the .com era, but it was really impressive because we were really feeling that it was something that will disrupt the communication systems and the way people interact together. It was completely different than anything that happened before. And the fact that France Telecom was providing the terminal for free was a big part of the success of this switch of mentalities, you know, because they were able to use this at home. Of course, for first it was not used for the messagerie, but since France Telecom provided a way for the companies to get money out of their services, it created you know, plenty of companies willing to be part of this experiment and to get money out of it by providing new services. You know, most of them were similar, but this was a very big success for France Telecom.
And how many people, so you had France Telecom in the middle, but then you also had the private entrepreneur culture that you were part of. Mm-hmm. You mentioned it was smaller than Silicon Valley. How many people you think were involved with this?
At the beginning, it was a few companies, you know. It was not so many, maybe in the 10 to 20s, you know, companies doing this kind of systems, creating this kind of software. It grew quickly because of the fact that the money that people were able to, the companies were able to get back for France Telecom was huge for the press editors.
And did you hang out with these with your competitors?
Yeah, we were competitors.
Right.
So, it was a mixed, you know, of careful hanging out. You know, we were sharing things, but not too much. It was very new, so everyone was asking about what the other one was using as a software, as a hardware, and for example, when we started to use the 3B15, we were the first to use the 3B15 as a Minitel server, and after that, Olivetti sold many of them for this purpose.
What were other people using? Because we also know that the French government was trying to use this to promote a French hardware industry promote Boule in particular.
Exactly, yeah. There was some computer, I don't remember, but there was this French system that was used. But when we try to switch to another system, we find it too complicated. So we just, you know, stuck with the Unix. But you know, yeah, there were a few other systems at the time, but they were not able to handle the you know the charge we needed to provide.
And did you have interaction with online entrepreneurs in other countries?
At one point, France Telecom tried to sell the Minitel, you know, in the U.S. It was Intelmatic that was doing this, and Georges Lenon that was doing this. And it didn't go very far. The problem that was in the U.S. that AT&T was not able to provide for free the terminal. So the whole idea was not, we couldn't, France Telecom couldn't replicate the same business model to another country. But we sold our system in Quebec that was using Alex, I think. So we created a system that was compatible with Alex, and in Germany with the Bildschirmtext. So we had a few sales in other countries.
And you were selling a system at that?
Yeah, we at one point, when we were done with the hosting, when we had this hosting era, at one point we tried to go further, and so we started to sell the kernel, the software. And so we sold a few of them, and we sold one to for the French lottery that used it for 3615 Loto. So that was interesting because it was our system was able to handle all this the need of you know users that were rushing when. They announced the results of the French lottery. So that was interesting because it was kind of we needed to adjust a lot of parameters in the system to be able to handle that charge.
But the system included, I mean, messagerie type.
Yeah, all of it.
But also what?
But it was for this purpose. It was just. It was very basic. It was, you know, just a few pages that will indicate the results, a few games, I guess. I remember there were a few games, but it was just created for this purpose because it needed much more users at one point than our regular system.
So you mentioned two things that might sound contradictory.
Uh-huh.
One thing is that you said France Telecom was really helpful because it provided the free terminal.
Yes.
It provided the kiosk system. Mm-hmm. So it really helped.
Yes.
The system going. At the same time, France Telecom was the state, mm-hmm. right? And you also mentioned that Minitel. You thought would really disrupt things and change the way that people started interacting,
mm-hmm.
Which might be you know, might be contrary to what France Telecom would have wanted in a way. One anecdote that maybe you can talk a little bit about, it is said that in 1986, mm-hmm. When students were protesting, there were big student demonstrations, mm-hmm. that the students used the messagerie mm-hmm. system mm-hmm. to organize the protest.
Mm-hmm.
Is that true? Were they using your system?
I don't remember that. I'm sure they were able to use it because it was, you know, available to anyone. So,
right, but yeah. You didn't actually see it going
on? I don't remember that.
Okay.
So, no, I don't remember that.
And do you think that France Telecom knew that it was kind of opening the can of worms when it launched the system, in terms of the disruption that would?
I don't think they knew exactly what they were doing. I think that for you know that for France Telecom it was a way for them to get rid of the paper listings at the beginning. So they started with this, but I'm not sure they were envisioning the whole ecosystem that will be created by offering for free this terminal. Yeah.
And what was your vision for the future of telematics and the online world?
It was really about a connection between people. Really, we wanted people to be able to connect together, to be at any point, at any moment, you know, from any terminal, being able to go and chat online. So we even created at one point some software on the PC to replace the Minitel on a more friendly way of interaction. And so some people used it, but the fact that the Minitel was, you know, very easy, and you know, you just switch it on, and it, you know, was operational, it was really a plus for it. And that's the most easy thing you can provide to a home to. For people to connect with.
So some of the stuff you mentioned kind of echoes what was going on here in San Francisco in the 80s. No?
No, I'm sorry. Let's take a break fairly soon, so whenever you think is logical, if it's now or after the next one.
I was gonna ask about the community of users.
Sure, let's do that.
You want to do that now? You want to take a break?
Yeah, that's fine, yeah.
Okay.
Let's go, yeah.
So yeah, a lot of the things you said in terms of connectivity between people really echoes what was going on in San Francisco in the 80s. Mm-hmm. The well was one of the systems.
Yeah.
And you hear the same kind of rhetoric from people.
Mm-hmm.
What was kind of the community of users? How did it evolve over time? And then what was going on outside of the actual online work? Because you said you organized parties,
that's true.
Can you speak about that?
Yeah, of course. So the community of people were really, it started with small networks of people. So these people knew each other at the beginning, of course, because there were doctors communicating together, so they knew that they were able to go on online and leave a message to another doctor and so on. And so they, I think that the fact that this, the core community was a small one, knowing each other, was helpful because it created this strong a sense of connection together. So these people came in and just wanted to get rid of the stress of the day, of the tension of the day. So they used it as a way to have a light, you know, light conversation. So at that point, they gave this to their friends and. It grew in. There was the core, a very strong core of users that knew each other, and there was all these people added by the ads we had at one point in the subway, in the magazines, and so on. So, and I think that the core of user were happy to see all these new, you know, people coming in. So, and I think that this core teached the way of using and interacting with the system, and so it created a strong, you know, bond between the users, because they were using the same way of interacting that was taught by the first users. And of course, you know, it was chatting, dating, of course, and people used that to date, and myself, I used it to date, and I had some, at one point I had a girlfriend that I found with the system. And so there were a few people that were able to marry using the system, and because of the popularity of this system, we started to organize parties, and these parties gathered like maybe a few hundred people, you know, at one point. So that was not too bad. And I remember one of the parties was organized at the Moulin Rouge in Paris. So we rented the whole space of the Moulin Rouge, and so people came and had dinner and dance, and it was fun.
And with the show?
I'm not sure we had the show, and only dining. Only dining.
And what year would
I think
the parties
it was in
the
80s, I guess 86. Yeah, about 86.
And geographically, were most, I mean, obviously that was people around
but
Paris.
Yeah, Région Parisienne, because that was the you know, the most where the all the militaires were, you know.
Yeah, because geographically, what was your distribution of users?
Most of them were Région Parisienne, and when, you know, Minitel started to get, you know, out of Région Parisienne, of course we saw all these people coming from all parts of France.
How big did your user base grow to eventually?
I'm not sure, but I think at one point we were like. So as I said, we sold like 1 million of these cables. So I think at one point we might have been, you know, I don't know, maybe I will say something completely, maybe 2 millions, I don't know.
People that had
the
login, essentially.
Yeah. We were not able to know exactly how many different users we had, because there were nicknames, and the nicknames were, you know, they were rotated. So at one point, you know, you couldn't count exactly.
Oh, France Telecom didn't tell you how many clients there were behind.
Not as the same. It's not the same way as the, you know, the internet, where you can, you know, spot the IP, and it was not the same way. I guess they could give us a rough number. Yeah.
So we talked about a service where you could download mm-hmm. software. We mm-hmm. talked about the Minitel Rose. Mm-hmm. You also mentioned games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, games. We had a few of them. We tried to when we wanted to, you know, create new services. So of course, games, as today with the internet, you know, you can find games on the web, on apps, and so on. So we at that point we tried to create some games for people to beside, you know, the usual messagerie and salon. So they were able to spend time playing games. So we had this game called Le Pendu, so they had to guess a word, and if not, they will see a drawing of someone being hanged and back. It's a classic, very classic game. I'm not sure we had Tetris. I think we had Tetris. I guess so. We had Tetris, we had this Jeu de la Vie, Game of Life, Cellular Automata. And we did something very silly at one point. We did something that was called l'horloge riche. So it was just a clock, a display of a clock on a Minitel with the big, big numbers, big letters, and that was just displaying the time of day. And it was a very expensive clock because it was costing to people one franc and 25 cents a minute. So. And some users were in the stats, we saw that it was used a lot. So I don't know where it came from, but it was used. It was very funny. So yeah, that was the...
On that note, speaking of you know, the time that it took to download stuff, some people looking at Minitel today, I said, well, it was really slow.
It was.
And Jean-Paul Maury has suggested that it wasn't necessarily just slow because of France Télécom, but it was slow because the editors of services were putting useless characters into the frames that you didn't see, but that made it longer to download.
Yeah, that was not true for our servers, for our protocol, because we tried to do the most efficient protocol using the Minitel modem. So we had a rate of, so it was 1200 baud. So I think our rate was above 110 characters per second. So we really had the very fast transfer.
Okay.
So I'm sure we got enough connections to not play on that
game. But it was done by others.
I'm sure it was done.
Okay.
There were many things done by other editors to increase, of course, the time spent by users online, of course, and it's game of money, that's it. Huh?
Yeah. Speaking of game of money, are you willing to talk a little bit about how much the revenue was for your company?
Yeah, so it was about when we opened the gates to 3615. At one point, it was I think 1 million a month of French francs, I guess. So about, and I'm sure it went above that, but. I don't remember exactly, but it was about that. So it was doing 12 to 15 million francs
a year.
Yeah.
And how much was your overhead? How costly was it to actually run your service?
It was, we did a really good margin. We did about, I think the best we had as a margin was 80%, so it was good. It was a good margin.
So how was your business organized? So you mentioned your partner.
Yes.
You mentioned
François.
The two people watching.
So, yeah.
Who were the other people? What were they doing?
So we were at the beginning. We were two of us, François and me. So someone else entered and. Take in charge all the finances, and after that we started to enroll, to hire employees that were developers. So they were working on the server, the apps. Mainly at the beginning, we had two developers, and. At one point, we had 12 to 14 people, I guess. working on the system. But so at the beginning, we were two of us, so François and me. And if we can compare to Apple, but that's a very François was Steve Jobs, and I was Wozniak.
Okay. And did you work out of a garage or?
We were in a cave. Okay. We started in a cave.
Where?
Not even a garage. And it was in, I don't remember the exact address, but it was in, of course, in Paris, in the, I think in the 15th arrondissement. And it was a very small cave of, it was about maybe 10 to 12 square meters, so it was a small space. So it was okay, so we could work all day long. So it was in the same conditions, you know, it was cool, and we had the bulbs to for the light, so we could work all night, all day long. It didn't seem too bad. It was okay.
And is this where your servers were?
Or? Yes, at the beginning, yeah.
Okay, and then did you move them to a special facility or?
No, we always, so at when we started to have this big server, we went, we moved to a place near the Hôpital Necker. So it was Rue de Sèvres, 163 Rue de Sèvres, and we had this big, huge server there. And it was, regular, store. You know, there was the cave that where the servers located, and we had a small office with a few desks. And
so you mentioned that office was right outside the hospital. Were you interning at the time? Or were you still a student?
It was not the same. No, it was another hospital.
Okay.
I don't know why we decided to move to near the. Maybe you know it was the proximity. We liked the proximity of an hospital. Maybe I don't know. We were drawn to the hospitals.
But did you study through the entire?
Yeah.
How did you juggle work?
I kind of. When I started to work on the servers, I slowly stopped, medical studies. But I was nearly at the end, so.
Did you graduate?
I did not.
Okay.
I did not. I just decided because I wanted to be a surgeon, and I knew I would not be able to get the right grade, so I decided not to.
To drop.
Yeah,
school.
Just okay. To drop. Yeah.
So what happened to the service? You mentioned you sold it at some point.
Yeah.
What was the motivation? What year was that?
It was in 87. So we really wanted to, we thought it was the right time to sell the company, to at least a part of the company. And so fortunately that someone was searching to buy, to invest in a company that was providing this kind of services. And so we meet these two guys that came and checked our infrastructure, systems, location, software, everything. And a few months later, they said, okay, maybe we can, we'll be interested in buying your company, and so in September of 87 we sold half of the company to the Maxwell Group. So and it lasted 2 years, because at that point it was kind of the peak of the Minitel era, and profits went slowly down, and so at one point the Maxwell Group asked us to find another investor to replace him, and so I went and find Press Invest that was searching for to increase its products, its telematic products. So they used our systems to host their services after that. So we provided these new products to them, and they passed all the they ported all their systems to our on our kernels.
And when you said you sell half the company, you didn't split the company, you sold half the shares.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Do you care to disclose the
It was a good amount of money.
Okay.
It was a good amount of money.
And the company, what was the company called, by the way?
Canal 4.
Canal 4.
Yeah, Canal 4.
Okay.
Yeah. Canal 4, because at that point, you know, it was the beginning of, I think there were only three channels when it started. So François had filed the name at the beginning, and he was searching for a name that was involved with TV, and so he took. I think he took Canal 4 because there was only three channels on the TV, and so he took Canal 4 because maybe he was hoping that at one point. TV channel will buy back the name or something like that.
And did you provide any teletech services over televisions?
I think we had at one point we tried something about that, but no. We had an in-house software that we sold for providing. It was a tool to create, you know, text on a video, but no, we didn't provide teletext by per se.
Okay, and so you sold half the company to Maxwell in '87, mm-hmm. And then when did Maxwell get out and Nouvelle Observatoire?
I think 2 years later. So we started with Nouvelle Ops in 1990.
Okay. And how long were you still involved with the company after that?
So I stayed as a manager during the Maxwell and Press Invest era, and I got out in 92, at the end of 92.
And who did you sell the rest of the interest to?
Press Invest.
Okay, so they bought the whole thing. Mm. And how did the culture change from beginning your cave to being in a more proper office to all of a sudden having the Maxwell Group part of your business?
Yeah, it was we had someone on our backs, you know, and it was we were not really in charge anymore, of course. So these guys were British, so they wanted to check all the numbers. So that was not in our, you know, way of thinking, because we were doing, you know, things, you know, more in an easy way. So at one point it was kind of annoying, of course, but well, this is business, and we got a lot of money in exchange. So these were the rules. But it went good. I'm not sure they used a lot of our products, and that's a shame because we had a really good products. They were not able to take these and maybe, for example, use them in other parts of the Maxwell Group.
Was Prestel dead at the time, or were they trying to bring your services to England?
No, AP, Associated Press, I think, at the time, and they wanted to create some kind of synergy between all these parts, and but I think it was a big huge group, and you know, the dealing with all these companies was not easy for them because it was young companies, products that they were not really used to. So, and we have, you know, very high level, we had in front of us, very high level CFOs of the group. So it was kind of a strange, you know, discussions. It was not the same language. So at one point, well, they decided just to get rid of us, I guess, because it was not in their, well, I don't know.
Yeah. But then you said that they sold to Presse Invest, and mm-hmm. you were still on board.
So they asked us to if we were able to find another investor, someone that will be able to acquire the company, their shares of the company. And so we went, and there was, you know, big. There was this big ecosystem at that point that with Presse Invest, that was one of them. Montblanc was another one of them. So we had a few offers. So two of them was one coming from, I guess, De Montblanc, and one was coming from Presse Invest. And well, we chose Presse Invest because we thought that it will bring us, you know, more. There was more on the table because we were being able to. Provide our products to Presse Invest, and they will use it in their centers.
And so how did that change the business model in practice?
We just get, you know, integrated to Presse Invest, but we were kind of autonomous, so that was nice. So we were still able to do what we wanted to do, to innovate, to create these new services, and so we were able to push our technology to and put it into their systems. So it was a good fit.
So you mentioned you got out in 92.
Yes.
What prompted that decision?
I think it was the end of the cycle. The end of the cycle. It was I did everything I can do in the this kind of Minitel technology, and it was other things were coming on, you know, on the technology front. You know, the early web. There was Audiotel in France that was starting, so I decided just to move because it was, I guess, the time.
So what did they do with the site? With your company?
With Canal 4, you mean?
Or? Yes. With how long was 3615SM around and the other sites?
So it stayed a few years after that, but it was sold many times. So the company was sold many times. In fact, I don't know exactly how many, but I think at least two or three times after that.
And what do you think happened to the community of users? Did you hear from these people?
As I told you, when we sold to Presse Invest, we sold a bunch of, we sold our company to the shares of Maxwell. But a few months before, SM was going, you know, going kind of down, because well, the community of users was shrinking, and we were talking with this guy that was doing the filtering, and was kind of the he was managing the community, kind of, you know, and so he asked us if we were able to sell him or give him, or I don't remember exactly, transferring the rights to the 3615, and we thought about it, and it was a good thing to do because it was kind of losing, it was starting to lose money. So we decided just to transfer all the property of the SM mark and servers, hardware, everything to this guy.
And what happened?
Well, I think he used it for a while, and I think it's a sad story because the guy had a you know, health problem, and he died not much after. So after that, I don't know what happened to the.
Is there anything that remains, you think? Are you still in touch with any of the people from back then, the users, the people you partied with?
Nah, it's a long time.
Yeah,
it's a long time. It's a long time, and since I moved to the U.S. A few years after, people move everywhere, so in the country, so it's difficult to keep a link to them.
So you mentioned that one of the reasons you left in '92 is that the user base was declining a little bit,
yes.
And you saw new stuff on the technology front, mm-hmm. like the web.
Yeah, web would you tell, yes.
After '93, you see a complete collapse of Minitel use.
Yeah.
When you left, did you have a sense that maybe you wanted to take your experience to the web?
Yes, and first I liked this technology we developed on with SM1. So I tried to move it to these new services that were offered with Audiotel. Enabled a higher speed, so people were able to download files much faster because they used the regular modems instead of Minitel. So at one point we switched everything to Audiotel lines, and so people were plugging. Like it was at, we started with the modems of 14 and 400 cables, and at the end of life of the service, it was 33 cables or something like that.
And so, what was the business model of Audiotel? Was it like the kiosk?
Very easy. It was kind of. Like the kiosk, but there was a few different rates. One of the highest rates was a fee at the connection plus a fee per minute. So we used the fee, the higher rates for specific files or apps that we wanted to that we were buying to some developers. So we gave some money to developers to build, software that we were selling on our service.
And so who were your clients?
There were like the Disney. There were clients from the Minitel that were using already our service, and that they were in demand of faster download. And more files, and easier way to connect. So this was a product that was on PC. They didn't need a Minitel, so that was easier for them to download files.
And what kind of files?
Any files. For example, you have these websites today like download.com. We had the same kind of products. Any file we had a base of creators that we were asking them to develop software, games, many games. So we gave them a part of the money we receive, and a lot of the files were coming from. The U.S. because we were buying, for example, CDs with the files, and we were putting a lot of them on the server.
So what was the interface like for the user? They had a PC at home?
Yeah, they had a
PC. Was there a graphical interface?
Exactly, graphical, graphical. So they can see the download, the download progressing, and the file, the name of the file. They were able to choose with they had the directory of the file. It was really easy. We wanted to do something really easy for them to be able to find the file, type of file, pictures, videos, executables, you know, and so on.
But mostly pornography, though.
No.
So what sort of files?
Software, executables, you know, games.
But when you say videos and images.
Videos, I don't remember what exactly we had. There was a lot of pictures of kind of nudity, yes, yeah. But videos, we have a very few, in fact. I don't remember, yeah. But yeah, you know,
but
kinky.
Not user generated.
Not user generated, no, no.
Okay.
No.
So there was no way.
No, only user generated were the softwares. Some of the users were contacting us and asking if they were able to sell their software through the system. So we had a few of these.
So you controlled all of the content.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
And then Audiotel also had, if I remember correctly, some interactive voice system.
Yes, yeah.
Were you trying to replicate the Minitel Rose, but as an audio version?
No, we sold more interactive systems, for example, for the, information. We had one for the meteo, one for traffic routier, so people were able to ask for traffic information. So they entered their zip code, and so they had a status of the traffic in their region. A lot of services for radios, you know. So people were able to play. So on the radio, they will say, okay, connect to this number, and so the user would be able to answer to a quiz on the service, and sometimes win a prize. I don't remember exactly what prize, but mostly interactive systems.
And at this point, were you still kind of thinking about these systems as a way to help people communicate as a disruptive thing, or did it become more of a kind of a hard?
So the audio, for me, the audio was not a way for people. It didn't feel the same as the Minitel on a communication point of view. It didn't add the same. It didn't let the people have this anonymity, because you have the voice, and the voice, you know, you can know everything by the voice of someone. So we didn't go to provide any kind of system that will let people gather together on a voice. A room or something like that. No, we didn't go to that kind of system.
And did you go into the web?
Much later, in fact. Much later, this audio hotel lasted like maybe 4 years. About 4 years. Yeah.
So that's 96.
Yeah, 96. At that point, I came to the U.S. Yeah.
So what prompted that move?
Boredom, I guess, in France. Everything, for me, I did everything in France I had to do in this kind of, you know, communication systems era, software, blah, blah, blah. So I wanted to I guess, experience something new. So I decided to with my wife to just move to the U.S. and try what was going on in the U.S. So we moved to Houston at first. It will be too long to explain, but for personal reasons. So we ended up in Houston. We started in Miami. We ended up in Houston. We spent a few years in Houston. And after the Enron crash, and at the moment HP bought Compaq, we left.
Were you involved in business there?
Yeah. So the business was difficult at that time in Houston, so I decided to...
What sort of business were you?
Consulting, you know, software. I wanted to try something else, so I was, you know, consulting for oil companies.
On software related?
Yeah, software related, yeah. So it was more, you know, kind of engineering, you know, software. It was a bit starting in the web, a bit of web, providing web services, a little bit. It was just the beginning of that.
And how did you meet people in the American oil business?
You know, there's a Schlumberger in Houston.
Sure.
So there were a lot of we met every week in. In a fast food, there was a gathering of French people in a fast food every week on Thursday nights, and so we just sat there, have a drink, have some food, and chat within the French people, and so we met with their relations and business relations.
Hmm. And is your wife in technology?
Not at all. She's a psychic, so completely different.
Mm. There can be psychics in technology.
Psychic?
There could be psychics around
in technology?
Technology too.
Yeah, but you know, it's not. I guess they don't use it a lot. There are websites and audio tell sites that provide the psychic. Services, yeah, but she's not doing that.
Maybe we can kind of look back.
Yeah, and there's a few business questions I'm not. Do you want to do it now? Or?
Which ones?
What did you ask about the other employees and stuff?
Yes, yeah, we covered that.
Okay, and then the money?
Yes.
And competitors? I realized. Didn't talk back with, well, Canal Cat became, that was the parent corporation. From what year?
Starting in 84.
Okay.
84, and we kept Canal Cat as the main company for the Minitel services.
So it was when it turned to Minitel, it became Canal Cat. Okay.
Yeah.
And. Who were your main? You were one of the first massages.
Kind of, yeah.
But talk about competitors.
Yeah, well there were a few competitors, small companies as us, mainly, and the big ones were the editors, la presse, providing services on Minitel, and. All of them were kind of messagerie rows at one point. It was fierce between competitors because we were all trying to get the users because there was the community of users was not infinite. So it was not a small community, but there were at one point in the Région Parisienne, there were like maybe at the beginning there was 50,000 Minitel when we started, so that was not so much. At one point to bring users on the sites, and I'm sure all of the companies was doing this, we were going on others' sites and just, you know, trying to bring the users to ours. And so that was going on a lot between the sites. Yeah, and I remember, I think at one point we got a call of, I don't remember which one, asking us to stop because we were going too much on their sites.
And your main, all of the main companies were competing.
Yeah, and so for doing this, we had an Apple II, I remember that, that was connected to a Minitel and was sending messages to people on I don't remember which one competitors list, telling them, okay, come and see me on 3615 SM, for example. I'm and I don't remember the exact messages. And I remember that that was done on the Apple IIc that François bought. And I think he wrote the basic program to do that at one point. Yeah, I think so.
And you talked about they've changed offices several times. Right? The ads. Obviously, you're all spending a lot of money on ads.
On the ads, yeah, I don't remember exactly.
You were using agencies for these?
The ads, yeah, I guess, I don't remember exactly. I think we were using, at one point we had someone that was managing the ad department, someone that was quelqu'un qui gérait la communication. Donc, she was, you know, doing all the ads, press, etc. So I'm sure she was using some companies to create the ads and,
But this was for you and your competitors. There was a real war.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, of course.
It was a significant expense.
It was. It was not so expensive. I don't remember how much, but I remember it was not so expensive. For example, we used when we did these campaigns in the subway, we can use a lot of these big the 4x3 in the subways, and I don't remember the price, but I think it was kind of low.
Did you ever run into any legal problems that you had to get lawyers?
At one point, yeah, we had this for the file download system because we were asking software creators to sign a contract with us to sell their rights to the software. So I remember that at one point we had a developer. So another company was doing the same thing, these guys sued us because they were asking us to pay, I think, 1 million francs, because we were using a software that was belonging to them, but in fact we had the contract before them, and so it ended up by them paying the lawyer's fees, and that was it.
Should we look back a little bit? So Minitel was an odd architecture, right? Mm-hmm. It was a hybrid architecture, mm-hmm. where you had decentralized servers, mm-hmm. with private entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. But the platform was run by the state, uh-huh. Very centralized through the kiosk system. What do you think the pluses and minuses of the platform were?
On the on the economical, you know, on the it's the nice thing about France Telecom and Minitel and was that they gave this for free. So that was fantastic because it was able to create a nice ecosystem of companies that were able to gather money about it. They did a good job in providing this architecture with their Transpac and X25 to connect. It was for the companies a bit complicated because they had to create these softwares, specialized software to connect to Transpac. So we had at one point black boxes that were in front of the computers to translate the X25 coming from the lines into something that the computers will understand. But beside that, the architecture was really something. It was a choice between this and, of course, IP, TCP/IP. But he did a really good job, so I can't complain.
At the same time, you did well. You know, you moved to the U.S. because you said, "Well, I did everything I could do in France."
Yes.
Did you feel constrained by the system?
No, I think there were more opportunities in the U.S. There were new opportunities, and the fact that in France, these many companies that were still using Minitel and providing Minitel services were stuck with their technology, with their investment, because a lot of money was poured in these systems. So they were not able to move out of that and create something new. For example, providing service through the web, though at one point you were able to access Minitel services through the web with there was some kind of platform that was providing that. But I think that the constraint was there, it was that this nice infrastructure that was put in place by France Telecom kind of restricted people and companies to see out of the box and you know, feel what was coming up with the web and with the World Wide Web.
So you did this as a university student, and then you ended up dropping out of school, not graduating.
Yeah, yeah.
Like many web entrepreneurs later.
Yeah.
If you had been an American college student in 83, mm-hmm. do you think you would also have dropped out of school to start an online business?
I think I had this passion. I was really intrigued by computers, by software, by electronic components. So I'm sure I would have done something about it. I'm sure it would have provided maybe more opportunities in the U.S. If it was not the Minitel, it would have been something else. Yeah.
So why do you think, still comparing to the U.S., Minitel was incredibly successful mm-hmm. domestically. Mm-hmm. It failed horribly in other countries. Mm-hmm. But even in the U.S., platforms like AOL or CompuServe weren't doing that hot in the 80s, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Why do you think Minitel was so successful where American online services at that time, pre-web, were not?
Yeah. Simply because France Telecom was providing for free the terminal. It was a huge amount of terminal that was, you know, pushed to the users. At one point, it was the country with the most the more terminal per users pre-web. So that's why, you know, people were able to use that because they have that at home. It was free, so they started by trying. You know, of course, you can try that easily. They used it for the annuaire, hein, l'annuaire les pages jaunes. And of course, they were bombarded by ads of messagerie rose, and so a lot of people tried that. And but since in the U.S. It was you had to subscribe to at the time for CompuServe. I subscribed at the time for. I was a CompuServe subscriber. It was costing money, so well, I guess that was the barrier. Huh?
So Minitel became incredibly successful, incredibly fast. But if you look at penetration rates, it also failed incredibly fast.
Yeah.
Why did Minitel fail?
I think it's because of the PC. You know, the PC penetration. You know, at one point. You had all the PC industry pushing, you know, with these very interesting, you know, programs and the way of interacting with the data that was provided by these software. So I guess, that's why.
And so. If you had, in retrospect, looking at this, knowing now why the web, you know, was successful, if you had been in charge of the platform, what would you have done differently? Would you have tried to save Minitel, upgrade it, or was it just time?
I think it could have been upgraded, you know, to something that would have. Use the web as a, you know, infrastructure, but it should have kept the ease of use of the interface for the end user, because it was, I think, a big part of the success of the Minitel was the ease of use. It was you just have to switch it on to open the keyboard, and that's it. It was on, and you were able to interact. So I'm sure that something similar could have been used by a certain kind of users. Because, for example, elderly people have been using this terminal for a long time, and at the end, when it was shut down. Well, they didn't have anything to use, and it's a pity for them, because it just, you know, cut them from a lot of things they were accessing before.
So Minitel failed, and is.
I don't think it didn't fail. Okay. I don't think it failed.
It just ended.
It ended. You know, it's a cycle. You know, like everything in nature, it's it just had to be replaced, or, you know, just ended, because at one point it was not the cost of maintenance was too high for France Telecom, I guess, to continue with this platform. And they couldn't find any, for example, replacements for certain parts, I guess. So I guess it needed to, 30 years is a long time in technology. Huh?
Right.
It's a very long time.
Now, French people tend to be pretty proud about the whole experience.
Yeah.
The feeling in America is not mutual.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Fred Turner, who is a professor at Stanford, mm-hmm. Recently stated in a French paper that Minitel is the running joke of Silicon Valley. And that seems to be fairly widely shared feeling. Why do you think that is? And
I don't know. Maybe he didn't get any money out of it. That's why.
So are you saying in a way that Silicon Valley, when it started with the web, did not learn from the Minitel? Are there things that you think?
I think it's better that it didn't learn because the platform was kind of restrictive. It didn't permit any, fantasy with the norm that was used by the Minitel. You had to do things a certain way, graphics were really hard to put on a Minitel screen. It was really the people had to learn a lot before being able to create a nice graphic on the Minitel, for example. So I think the fact that the web platform was really open and let people do whatever they had in mind is a very good thing. Since the ecosystem was not present, if AT&T, for example, was able to give a terminal, a specific terminal, I think maybe things would have been different, and people would have use this terminal to connect to services. But it's a different country, it's a different economic system, so things are completely different.
But are there things in contrast that you think internet entrepreneurs should learn from Minitel and haven't learned? Mm-hmm.
Technology-wise, you can always learn from what have been done, on the platform, because a lot of things, coding, implementing algorithms and so on are kind of used on web servers, because we can use kind of the same algorithms. Also with the apps, a lot of apps were able to be ported to the web also. So yeah, on this, yeah, of course they can learn something. On the economic side, it's really completely different. It's there's nothing like that in the US, so I guess the only thing that was a problem for France, because of that they didn't go through all the experience that took place here with economic model using advertising and so on. So that's the big difference.
And do you feel that on going on that Minitel might have impaired the development of the internet in France?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, because all this money, involved in these companies, it was big assets. So it was difficult to move quickly to get rid of all these systems and to move to web platforms because there was no the rentability was not there. There was not the same economic model, so they didn't. They were not able to shift to another model quickly.
What do you think the most remarkable use of Minitel has been, and/or of your service?
The most remarkable communication was for me the most remarkable. It was the way people were using it to communicate together, because it had a really special effect on them. It was a way of getting rid of their stress. So for me, it was I think it was the most important thing, something that was able to connect people.
Can you fill in the sort of from Houston till now? What have you been?
So I left Houston. In fact, after 9/11, I kind of left Houston after Enron, but I went, back for a few times. And when 9/11 occurred, 6 months after, I decided to get back to France for a few months, and so I ended up doing some work for Orange at that point, and after that, well, I came back to the Valley.
Because you wanted to come back here, or for the job? Or
I think I wanted to. I thought I was going to come back to the U.S. I was not really sure, but I wanted to come back. So well, it was at one point I had this opportunity, so.
And I mean, there are other Minitel pioneers
in the Valley.
In Orange.
Recently. In Orange, of course.
I mean, is it through old connections that you met George?
Yeah, because George, in fact, was the. If I didn't mention it, George was the was managing the telematic at Press Invest. He was in charge of telematic at Press Invest, so I met him for that occasion, of course, in the 90s, and he came a few times in our office at Canal 4 because he was showcasing services to international companies. Because we had a pretty decent system, so he wanted to prove that Minitel was a nice product to export.
So it was because of him you worked for France?
I got in touch with him at that point, and I think he offered me to do some job for Orange at that point, yes. Yeah, it was Thierry Breton at the time that was managing the company, yes. So I did something for the Comex, and it was kind of interesting.
And since then, what have you done here?
And so I've been working for Orange since then as Skunk Works, their director. So I can't tell you exactly what I'm doing because it's secret, but it's kind of working on some special projects for on the side and doing edgy stuff, mainly edgy stuff.
Is there any advice you would give to young?
Before this one, so is edgy a main theme of your career? Edgy, disruption.
Of course, I like disruption. I like to think what will happen in the next 10 years. For example, if I can try something, for example. I would try to. If I was the CEO of Apple, for example, I will go and try to push quantum computing, because I'm sure that at one point there will be no more physical networks or radio networks, and everything will be connected to quantum physics. So, and they should, you know, try and go on this path.
Quantum entanglement. Well, Google is investing.
Yes, exactly. Google, yeah, absolutely. They bought something from the D-Wave company, of course.
Well, where do you think the, where will the online world be, say, 20 years from now?
I think it will be, all will be on mobile, of course. And I think that there will be no more mobiles anymore. It will be
no more desktop.
No more desktop, but no more phones. You will be, I guess, you will be kind of connected without a physical device. I guess maybe something will be implanted in your body, or you have some kind of device connected to your brain that will let you interact immediately with anyone you want. And yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, 20 years is a very long time.
Quantum chat,
I'm sure, yeah, absolutely. People are already putting some NFCs in their skin, you know, to be able to pay on the cashier, so.
Yeah, I've read articles. Yeah. You're not going to do that at Orange?
No, I don't think so.
What suggestions would you offer to young people? One's interested.
Be curious. Find your passion. You know, as long as you have a passion, follow it. That's the only. I think it's the most important thing. Have passion in life.
And if you don't have anything else, I'll just ask: is there anything? Anything that you would like to add that you feel?
No, and I think I was really happy to participate and to be able to be able to remember all these fun events and fun period in my life.
No, thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Wonderful interview. Thank you.
Thanks.